Hey everybody, Dan here, welcoming you to another episode of Old School Saturday. This is the classic throwback of a Be Kind Rewind. Today we are looking at Dumbo with a few tweaks, modifications. You know how it works by now. So I'll stop talking and y'all sit back and enjoy the fun that is Dumbo.
Who was all ears. But gossips discover the scandalous truth about the new arrival.
Have I got a trunk full of dirt?
His mother goes wild.
Down! Jumbo, down!
Socially, he was washed up. His only friend, a mouse.
You know, lots of people with big ears are famous.
Oh, boy. All we gotta do is build an act. Make you a star. A headliner. Dumbo the Great!
Walt Disney's Dumbo brings you a trainload of exciting new characters. Wild animals. Ferocious beasts. Ponderous pachyderms. Jungle giants. Casey Jr., the train with a personality. And believe it or not, the most delightful Disney sequence you've ever seen, the Parade of the Pink Elephants. See Dumbo's magnificent fall to fame, the most sensational climax ever filmed.
Hello everyone and welcome to another very special episode of Be Kind Rewind, a Disney movie podcast. I am one of your hosts, Dan Tind. With me, as always, the inimitable Ichabod Bones. How you doing, dude?
Doing good. Staying at home like I'm supposed to.
Yeah, for a few.
Actually, I'm allowed to go out now.
Why would you want to go out? Corona is everywhere. It'll get you. You don't want to go anywhere. Just stay in your house. Have everything delivered by drones, man. Delivered by drones.
Yes.
Or better yet, by Dumbo.
Yeah.
Well, we are covering Dumbo tonight. Speaking of drones that fly around.
Oh, Dumbo, yeah.
Which is going to be an interesting episode. I already know it will be.
Yeah, it kind of let me down, except for the one scene. Coming off of the Reluctant Dragon, this is a little bit of a, But that's okay, we'll get into it.
Yeah. So, this one was released October the 23rd, 1941. It did $1.3 million in revenue, which, compared to the last two, was up. And that equates to about $22.8 million in today's
monies. And this was my first time watching it all the way through. This is one of those where you caught bits and pieces. For what I thought it was going to be a whole lot longer than an hour and 4 minutes.
Yeah, me too. It was over before you knew it.
Yeah. So was this your first time watching it?
First time all the way through, yeah. Just like you, I've seen bits and pieces, but never watched it straight through.
Okay. Well, this movie started off with a poem about a stork that when I heard it, I thought it was they were talking about the U.S. Postal Service.
Yeah.
Because it was neither sleet nor hail nor something else will keep the flock of storks from bringing the kids to the parents. And so it starts off with a poem, and then that goes to a bunch of storks flying in a formation, and they see Florida. First time we've actually seen a state in a movie, if I'm right.
I mean, is this foreshadowing? This was 20 years before Disneyland, 30 years before Disney World.
I've got no clue, but it looked like it was South Florida, so I think they were taking it down to Miami.
Miami.
Yeah. This was where the winter quarters of the circus was being housed, and I don't think I ever saw an actual name for the circus. Did you?
I don't remember seeing anything, no.
But there was bears being delivered, Kangaroo Joey, then a hippo that falls asleep in the bottom of a pool, which was
weird. And there's bubbles coming out, like they're breathing air and exhaling out bubbles underwater.
And then there was 5 tiger cubs and a baby giraffe. They were all very well drawn, which, seeing as how we saw most of this being developed in The Reluctant Dragon, we know why it was all being well drawn. And then from there, we cut to a sad elephant who we find out is Mrs. Jumbo, who's looking around for her package, and every one that she looks at, she gets a little bit sadder.
Yeah, it's sad.
And so from there, the train loads up with the animals, and it shows the babies and the mamas and daddies that were just delivered to each other. And again, it shows Mrs. Jumbo stopping, looking up longingly, and then she gets pushed from behind by what I thought was actually a male elephant, but come to find out it's the grand dame of the group. And so they all go into the train, and they have a trouble closing the train up behind the last elephant.
Too big.
And we have another callback to The Reluctant Dragon because of the all aboard whistle lady.
Right.
And y'all can listen to last week's podcast about The Reluctant Dragon if y'all want to know what we're... So the train sets off, and a final stork comes out of the mist or the clouds, and he has to plop down on a cloud because he's been lost, obviously. And he starts looking around, and he's like, all right, I'll take the 6 up to the 725, down to the 490. Then I see Bob's Burgers get a tank of gas there. Oh, there's the train. He's like, there I guess is. This is our... That's where I'm looking. And he almost loses the package like 4 or 5 times while he's trying to figure out where he's trying to go for. Not a good delivery person, I will tell you that.
Not very attentive.
No. But he comes down and starts calling out Mrs. Jumbo, and 3 or 4 elephant trunks pop up out of the elephant car. And so he goes down, recites a couple poems, has her sign for her package, which nobody else had to do.
Yeah.
And she signs an X.
Apparently she's part of the Generation X.
Or she just never learned how to read and write.
Or that.
But you can suck it! Go ahead. And so the stork sings happy birthday to Jumbo Jr. and takes off after getting caught on a nail for the mail car. And this is where the movie gets a little bit weird, I thought, because everybody was all, oh, that's such a sweet, cute elephant.
Yeah.
And then he sneezes. And then all of a sudden, he's a freak.
Then the ears come out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the elephants grabs one of the ears, and Jumbo smacks her, which you're messing with her baby, so I could understand that.
Yeah.
And that's when Jumbo Jr. gets renamed our title character, Dumbo. And Jumbo slams the gate, and she lays down, and the two of them go to sleep. And train just goes along. We got a little engine that could reference as it's going over the mountain. I think I can, I think I can, I think I can. I thought I could, I thought I could, I thought I could.
Yeah.
And it pulls into whatever town it was supposed to stop at. This is where we actually see the elephants being exploited, along with a lot of, what's the proper term for them nowadays? People of color.
Yeah.
As they start to sing about wasting their money on wine, women, and song, for lack of a better term. And so that all goes on. Supposedly, I'm thinking that's supposed to make us feel good about all the elephants. And it ends with Dumbo falling in a mud puddle. No, that's actually, I'm wrong. There's a parade through town, which ends with all the elephants and Dumbo falling in a puddle, causing everybody to laugh at.
Yeah.
And Dumbo gets a bath, and after he's done with his bath, the crowd starts to... And for whatever reason, the kids can go underneath the ropes, which is definitely not allowed in today's.
Yeah, security wasn't very tight.
No. But, so one of the kids gets under the ropes, grabs Dumbo, grabs his ears, and Mrs. Jumbo attacks him, beats him, causing all kinds of riots, and she gets shackled down and thrown in a mad elephant cart for her trouble for trying to keep up with child. And so, what was that?
Irony is, I lost you for a second, I think. I was going to say the irony is this kid who's making fun of Dumbo has ridiculously big ears himself.
Yeah.
As far as, there's also big teeth. Kind of remind me of in Pinocchio, when the kids were on Pleasure Island and they were starting to transform into donkeys, and the one boy was halfway between donkey and human. That's almost what that boy looked like to me, like maybe it was a throwback.
Yeah,
with the big teeth and the big ears.
I could definitely see that as a reference from that movie. But she's defending her child, so for that she gets shackled and tied down, and this causes other problems, including circus conductor getting thrown into water.
Yeah. She plays human bowling.
Yeah, exactly. So you see this mad elephant cart. Next thing that you see is Dumbo sitting all by himself, and the other gaggle of females are gossiping about how it's so sad. And one of them actually takes up for Mrs. Jumbo, I think. But the rest of them are like, no, that's not how it actually worked.
Yeah, Dumbo was an outcast. They turned their backs and shunned him, it seems like.
And that's where we get introduced to the mouse of the episode.
Yeah, not that mouse.
No. Timothy Q. Mouse. I don't ever remember him actually being named. Do you? Did you hear him actually introduce himself?
No, now that you mention it, I don't remember, yeah.
Anyway, Timothy Q. Mouse, who we once again also saw in The Reluctant Dragon, he's introduced and he consoles Dumbo and says he sees nothing wrong with his ears. The, like you said, the other females shut Dumbo out of the circle, and Timothy walks right up underneath all of them and scares them all up into the rafters.
Yeah.
Because, you know, mice, elephants, they're all scared of each other.
Yes.
And this is where Dumbo finds that he has a friend. Timothy compliments his ears, and they work on trying to make Dumbo a star, which ends up with Timothy walking into the circus conductor's bedroom and starting to concoct a plan. So the plan is to have the elephants form a pyramid, and Timothy and Dumbo are working on Dumbo's part, and Dumbo trips over his ears again, and Timothy's like, this isn't going to do. So the next thing that we see Dumbo with its ears tied up on top of his head like he's wearing a Russian babushka hat.
Yeah.
Which, as he starts to run towards the pyramid that he's supposed to land on the very top, they come undone, and he crashes into the springboard, causing him to fall into the elephants and cause the tent to basically fall down with everybody in it. End of the movie. Good movie. No, wait.
Should have been, yeah.
So we go from that to all the elephants complaining about their various injuries. One of them has its tail up in a sling. The Grand Dame has her nose in a sling, and every time that she moves it, she's complaining. And apparently, because of Dumbo's action, he's been made into a clown. And because of this, he is no longer an elephant. Okay. We can deal with that.
Yeah.
Movie shifts to the next city, and Dumbo's in a baby clown makeup, and turns out that he's just supposed to fall down off the burning building into a vat of, I'm thinking, whipped cream.
Like pie filling, something like that.
Yeah. And everybody loves that, and the clowns love it, and drink a toast. And Dumbo's upset about how he's been made fun of. And Timothy's like, oh, I forgot to tell you, we're going to go see your mama tonight.
Yeah, out of nowhere.
Yeah. He's like, I got you a special visitor's pass. You can go see her. So they walk off, find Mrs. Jumbo, and Mrs. Jumbo takes Dumbo into her trunk and sings him a song. And then we cut back to the clown still celebrating and saying that they need to have a raise because of Dumbo's success and need to have him jump off like a thousand. So after Dumbo and Timothy go to see the mom, and the mom sings a song while Dumbo's in the trunk, scene cuts back to the clowns, who are all getting drunk, and they declare that they're going to have a new act where Dumbo's going to be jumping off a 1,000-foot building. And one of them walks out, and as he does so, he dumps a bottle of champagne into Dumbo's water. And Dumbo and Timothy come back, and Dumbo's crying, and Timothy tells him to take a drink of the water. Everything will be fine, because Dumbo's got hiccups. And this is actually the part of the movie that, for some reason, I remember the most, because it's the pink elephants on parade, which is like 6 minutes of Fantasia-like elephants dancing around, making all kinds of different shapes. They were cars, they were salsa dancers, and slowly it dissolves as they all bunch up on Dumbo. And this is where the controversy begins, I will bet you're about to say. Because they wake up. Well, no, actually, a bunch of 5 crows land in a tree and start talking to Timothy and Dumbo, and they're like, and Timothy, and he's like, what are you doing down here on the ground? The leader of the crows is like, on the ground? What you doing up in my tree, man? And Timothy's like, what do you mean? I'm not in your tree, and looks down and gets all scared and backs up into Dumbo's face, and they fall down the tree into a pond. And they're like, well, how do you think we got up in this tree? Well, what, maybe you flew. And this was the song about elephant flying. And so the crows and Timothy start working on a plan to see if it's actually true. And there's a magical feather.
Of course.
And so they take him up to the top of a cliff and tell him to start flapping his ears. No problems there. I mean, it's a movie. What's the worst that can happen?
Right.
So Dumbo takes off, and the crows are flying along behind him, singing about seeing an elephant fly, and they head off to the next town, which is the big town. So obviously this had to have been Orlando. And so Timothy's like, Dumbo, are you ready? Are you ready to show everybody what we can do? And Dumbo's like, yeah, let's go ahead and do it. And so they're up top 1,000-foot burning building, and Dumbo jumps, and the feather comes loose. And Timothy's like, flap your wings, man. Flap your ears, man. We're going to crash. Don't do that.
And panic sets in.
And suddenly he takes off like a B-52 bomber and dive bombs everybody, and they go all around the town, or they go all around the circus tent. And that makes Dumbo the first flying elephant. And you see his face on several newspapers, and the movie ends with Dumbo and Mrs. Jumbo reunited and traveling in a private car. The end.
And a fancy train with the crows in tow. Yep.
Yeah. So it was, I mean, for all the build up for it to be done in like 3 minutes, I mean, I don't understand unless it was to make you have a heart for Dumbo, why this wasn't like a 25-30 minute movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe they were just trying to fill it, to stretch it out so that it could be a feature length instead of a short.
That's possible. Mm-hmm. So what did you think of the movie?
I don't know. Yeah, I had never seen it before, so I was expecting another great, like a Pinocchio or Snow White. It just wasn't that great to me, other than the pink elephant scene, which was fun. But again, it was just more Fantasia. I don't know. I didn't find it to be as politically incorrect by modern-day standards as much, except for the crow scene, but even so, that wasn't too bad. Not bad at all by their standards, but comparatively by modern standards. Yeah, I just found it, I don't know, except for the scene when Dumbo and Jumbo were reunited in the mad elephant cage, and she picks him up and cuddles him and cradles him. That really pulled on your heartstrings a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit.
But other than that, I was just thinking, this movie is just okay, I guess. Yeah. Kind of like the ride at Disneyland. It's just okay.
I've never ridden the ride at Disneyland, so I cannot say.
Or Disney World. It's there, too. Disney World has two of them, side by side.
Hmm.
Two identical Dumbo rides. One's counterclockwise and one's clockwise. But I digress.
So, apparently, speaking of the crows, there was controversy.
Yeah.
Because the original name for the leader was Jim Crow.
Oh.
And yikes. His name was later changed to Dandy Crow. So that way, it wouldn't have as much controversy.
Jim Dandy. Got it.
But that was the only real controversial part, other than the underage drinking by the elephant, which...
which formed green bubbles. It's funny how one bottle of champagne diluted in a, I don't know, 150-gallon trough of water would still be enough to put an elephant into a drunken stupor, into a hallucinogenic comatose state. Yeah. Seems a bit much, but hey, it's a cartoon. What are you going to do?
Well, I definitely wasn't expecting for just the elephants to be working on putting up the tent.
Oh, yeah, hammering in the stakes and such.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there was that, but, I mean, nobody cares about that, because that's animal exploitation back before that was uncool, too.
Yeah, wasn't a thing back then.
Wasn't anything but a chicken wing.
Yeah.
So, you've mentioned the rides at Disney. Rides, plural.
Yeah.
Is there any other impact of this movie on today? Or today's impact on the movie?
I'm trying to think. I don't know if there's a whole lot in today's... Not even any of the songs aren't really memorable, except when I seen Elephant Fly.
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of still mentioned.
Oh, come on, man. You don't hear Pink Elephants on Parade every day down there?
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, I'm with you. This one definitely wasn't... It didn't have as big of a impact on today's society, with the exception of it being re-released, with Colin Farrell playing somebody. I don't know who he played.
Oh, do you? I haven't seen that one yet, but I just realized it's maybe Tim Burton, so I'm expecting it to be Nightmare on Elm Street, Edward Scissorhands creepy.
Yeah, it might be. And we will get to that in 15 to 20 years.
Oh, I think maybe the Casey Jr., maybe I think I can. I think this is where that originated, maybe. This is the first appearance that we've seen it, so maybe. Unless there was a short, the short that was referenced in The Reluctant Dragon came out as a separate short, but this is the first time it was in a feature film. And that's also a ride in Disneyland, at least.
What's that, Casey Jr.?
Yeah, the train. There's a train in California.
Hmm.
There's a train that plays that song, and you can hear that dialogue. Yeah, I think I can.
Did not know that. The Little Engine That Could was actually written in 1930. So we're talking 10 years prior that it actually came out. So, I mean, this movie had a lot of quote-unquote callbacks to other movies, because we had several callbacks to The Reluctant Dragon because of the engine, because of the actual scene where they were showing Timothy Jr. and the actual class where they were learning how to draw elephants. And it kind of makes you wonder if they were doing this for that movie or if this was just an afterthought because they thought, well, this is the next movie coming up, so let's make the people want to watch because we're showing them bits and pieces of it.
Yeah.
I don't think this is actually mirrored in culture at all. Well, considering there aren't any circuses anymore.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's not really culturally relevant anymore. Animals aren't treated that way as much anymore. They don't parade them around like that anymore.
I'm trying to think. Well, haven't been to the fair in a couple of years, but there's always... I want to say there's a elephant act at the local circus for the with the fair, but I don't know if that's been... if that happened since Ringling Brothers closed it.
I don't know.
But the pugilistic pachyderms, as they were called...
Wow.
So, I guess the big question is, does Dumbo fit into today's society, given that it is not culturally acceptable for an animal to be treated unfairly, or to be exploited, or to be separated from its mother, unless you're Joe Exotic?
Yeah. Well, I mean, we kind of briefly touched upon it a minute ago, but they just remade Dumbo last year, so I guess I'd be interested to see what they did differently. Because you know it had to be politically correct, Disney in 2019. So I don't know. I haven't seen it yet. So now we have to go back and watch that. We'll get to it sometime next millennia.
Exactly.
But somehow they made it culturally relevant, politically correct, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, I think it's politically correct for today's society would be the proper terminology. But with this being an hour and 4 minutes long, and like I said, it could have been 30 minutes long, and it would have been fine with me.
Yeah, it seems like it was a short that they wanted. They wanted to make a full-length theatrical release, and they just didn't have enough material. So they said, let's make the elephant drunk, and let's come up with a drunk sequence.
And then at the very end, we're going to make him fly because, you know, elephants, they all fly. Because they're all superheroes.
Exactly, yeah.
But...
It made enough money, so it was worth it for Disney to do it.
Yeah, that's for sure, because we're talking about this one made $1.3 million, and, I mean, we had The Reluctant Dragon. Well, that wasn't really it was a feature film, but it did 960. So this was the first movie that actually went on an upswing for them, and I think they started to ride that momentum with this and the next few releases, because I don't think the next couple dropped off the list.
Yeah.
The next one that was actually released was Bambi. A bunch of money.
Yeah.
Yeah, it made... Well, we'll talk about it, but it made about this much, so it... I mean, they're going in the right direction, especially with a war going on. What was that?
It made this many?
Yeah. It made that money. For those of you who are listening to the audio podcast, because we do not have a video podcast, Icky is holding up seven fingers.
This many.
It made this many dollars. Do you have anything else on this one? Because, I mean, it was a short film. It was that was no doubt fluffed out to get to feature length, which we've talked about.
The only thing that I thought was remotely noteworthy, and it's not really that noteworthy, is just in that pink elephant sequence you were talking about, the elephants were in several different color patterns and shapes and such, and I remember one of them where the elephant was standing up and walking bipedally on its back feet, kind of with its arms hunched like it was marching forward in an angry fashion. But the elephant was made entirely out of elephant heads. The body and the legs and the arms were all made out of a bunch of elephant heads that came together like Voltron or something. And it kind of reminded me of in Wreck-It Ralph 2, Ralph Breaks the Internet, when the big Ralph is made by a bunch of little Ralphs. I don't think there's any relation whatsoever, but it just kind of reminded me of that. I thought that was worth bringing up.
Yeah. Yeah, now that you mention it, I do see the relevance, because it was referenced more or less in another movie, even if they didn't say, oh, well, this is from that one Disney movie that was 70 years ago.
Yeah. But, maybe, maybe not, but it was just a fun,
yeah,
a fun tidbit to bring out.
I'll give you that one. So we're going to put a bow on this one. What'd you think?
I think it's good to go.
Okay.
Yeah, a mean bow.
All right. Well, our next movie, which was actually brought up to us by one of Icky's friends, is going to be, and we're actually going out of order, and we do apologize, but we didn't find out about this one until afterwards. It was actually the 1940 RKO Pictures release of Swiss Family Robinson, which was actually not a Disney movie, but it is owned by Disney. And so that is your homework for next week.
Yeah, not the 1960s version we all know and love, way back before, an old black and white 40s version.
So that is your homework. I think it's an hour and 33 or 35 minutes, so it's a little bit longer than this one. But that's your homework for next week. Until then, we want to thank you for listening. And if you would like to drop us an email, we have an email of bekindrewinddmp@gmail.com. Once again, that is bekindrewinddmp, which stands for Disney Movie Podcast, @gmail.com. And everybody stay safe out there.
Have a good one.
Thank you for listening to this podcast. If you would like to send us an email, you can do so at bekindrewinddmp@gmail.com. DMP stands for Disney Movie Podcast. Once again, thank you for listening, and have a wonderful day.
Dumbo, the ninth wonder of the universe, the world's only flying elephant.
Did you ever see an elephant fly?
Well, I seen a horse fly.
I seen a dragon fly.
I seen a house fly.
See, I seen all that too. I seen a peanut stand and heard a rubber band. I seen a needle that winked its eye. But I be done seen about everything when I see an elephant fly.
What'd you say, boy?
I said when I see an elephant fly. I seen a front porch swing, heard a diamond ring. I seen a polka dot railroad tie. But I be done seen about everything when I see an elephant fly. I saw a clothes horse, a rab and buck.
And they tell me that a man made a vegetable truck.
Well, I didn't see that. I only heard.
Just to be sociable, I'll take your word.
I heard a fireside chat.
I saw a baseball bat.
And I just laughed till I thought I'd die.
But I'll be done seen about everything when I see an elephant fly. Bow, shaw, bada-da-doo-doo. But I'll be done seen about everything when I see an elephant fly.
With the wind.
When I see an elephant
fly. Faster, faster! Get up flying speed. Retract your landing gear. Raise your fuselage. Take off.
No use, Dumbo. I guess it's just another one of their...
Look! Hot diggity! You're flying! You're flying!
Why, he flies just like an eagle.
That's better than an airplane.
Brother, now I've seen everything. But I've been unseen about everything when I see an elephant fly.
Folks are sure in for a surprise.